Hi, good morning, guys. So it's my pleasure today to introduce Ballerina at WSO2Con. So we just released the 0.95 version, which is a preview version. So the language is going through several iterations. So during the rest of this track, like we will, so I will be giving an initial introduction to the language and some of the fundamental concepts in the language. And throughout the rest of the day, and even like tomorrow, we will go into more detailed view into like different aspects related to like data integration, you know, other connectors and stuff like that. Okay, so so you can go to ballerinalang.org and check out Ballerina. So we have samples. So samples will be a good place to get started with. So what is Ballerina? So I think Kasun already covered some of these aspects. So first we'll look at what it is, and then we'll go into why we need another language, right? So Ballerina is an event-driven parallel programming language for networked applications. So like most of us here have used different technologies to write networked applications, right? But in most cases, like when it comes to the network, right? You have to deal with certain conditions. So it's not a primary thing in most languages. So one of the primary design aspects when it comes to Ballerina is it's designed for event-driven parallel programming for networked applications. One of the things that when we talk to you, like most of you have used, some of you have used our products and so on, when we think about integration and interactions, we always think of, you know, one system talking to another system. So we use a sequence diagram metaphor to describe integration flows. So that's the most natural way of you know, describing different integration flows. So so one of the things that one of the key design points is why don't we start like thinking of an integration problem with a sequence diagram metaphor? Why don't we have a language which also, you know, brings that as a first class thing? So rather than, you know, going onto a whiteboard, designing it as a sequence diagram interaction between different systems, why don't we, you know, how do we reflect that in the code? So when it comes to the code, that aspect is not reflected. So this is another design point in Ballerina. So it's strongly and statically typed. And it's designed to work with different data formats, JSON, XML, all these things are native data formats. So it's not second class. So SQL, MIME, HTTP, WebSocket, different integration protocols and network protocols, all of these things are first class components or first class fundamentals in the language. And it's modular. So you could like have your, it's modular, it's extensible. You could introduce your own, let's say, binary communication protocol. Let's say you need GRPC based communication. So the things like that can be brought on as add-ons. So without requiring any changes to the language core. And from day one, one of the key focus areas has been, this has to be microservices, serverless, and container friendly, right? So when it comes to those aspects, right? Low memory footprint, fast boot up times, discoverability, all these things are key aspects when it comes to writing modern integration systems. So these are some of the key fundamentals. So why yet another programming language? Why can't we do this with some existing general purpose programming language? Why didn't we like write this as an add-on, let's say Java library, rather than a completely new or a Node.js library, rather than introduce a completely new programming language? So these are one of the questions that we get very often. So like I described, the core design fundamental is the network integration aspects are a primary thing in the language. So it is our fundamental objective is to make it easier to consume and produce networked services and applications. So how many of you have like tried out Ballerina? Okay, a few of you have already tried it out. So if you would have seen that we have like got inspired by language features from a bunch of languages. So each language has its own weak points and strong points. So when we designed Ballerina, one of the key aspects was, you know, to get the strong points from different languages and make it as intuitive as possible when it comes to integrating systems. So motivation related to Ballerina, type system mismatches. So when it comes to any general purpose programming language, understanding of, you know, typically JSON, XML, SQL, all these things are not a core part, right? These are add-ons, or, you know, these are second class aspects in the language. So in Ballerina, these are fundamental aspects. So when we look at some of the samples, you'll be able to see what you're talking about. And generally, it's difficult or poor at doing asynchronous programming, right? So one of the motivations behind Ballerina is you should be able to write asynchronous, concurrent, parallel programs and network resilient programs. So so when you talk to a particular endpoint, if the endpoint is down, it's the responsibility of the developer now to, you know, to build in some retry mechanism or a failover mechanism. Typically languages do not provide those aspects. In Ballerina, you know, what we've discovered is, you know, the network is always going to have issues, right? The network, there'll be network failures. So as a language, we should be able to be resilient. So the language itself has to have the resiliency features to deal with this type of different failures. And the typical DSLs when it comes to integration, you know, are not workable at scale. So when you write, or when you have a complex integration, it basically becomes unmaintainable. So this is one of the other problems that we have. So at scale, when you have a simple system, you know, you have two systems which you are integrating, that type of scenario, the DSL would be simple. But then, like, as you add on more and more integration points and other, you know, resiliency features and so on, your DSL becomes really hard to maintain. And the traditional integration technologies are heavy, unsuitable for the modern microservices, serverless, containerized world. So let's look at a hello world. So we'll start with that. So it's very simple. So as you can see, this is one of the entry points. So one of the entry points in a Ballerina program is the main function. So it's a functional programming language. So this is how you do a hello world. So there is a built-in function called println. So you just can print anything. So you can pass command line arguments into the program. So when you run Ballerina, so this is how you call the runtime. So this is running in interpreted mode. So there are two modes. So in this mode, we are giving a hello world.bal file, a Ballerina file. And we are saying Ballerina run, and we are just giving that code. So that's how you run a hello world. So this is the most simplest case. And Ballerina knows JSON, XML, and data. So different data formats that are fundamental to integration. All part of the Ballerina type system. So like integer, string, you know, float, and so on. XML, JSON, data table, these are primary types in the Ballerina type system. So it's deeply unified and integrated both syntactically and semantically. And there are data transformations across all of these formats. So that can be done visually as well as programmatically. And transactional data management is another key feature when it comes to these data formats. So let's look at the different data formats in detail. So JSON is a union type. So a JSON variable that you declare in Ballerina can be a string, number, boolean. So this comes from the spec itself. It could be null, or it could be a typical JSON literal format like this. So some of you at the back might not be able to see. Sorry about that. So this at the bottom, what you see is a literal JSON syntax. So we have something called a record type in Ballerina. So what we have, like structs, maps, and so on. So these are some other primary data types. So a JSON, a literal JSON, looks very similar or the same as a struct. So you can, you know, convert between JSON to and structs and so on. Structs are structures, like you know, like in C we have this, the structs, C++, and so on. So it's the same thing or similar concepts that we have in Ballerina. So with XML, what we have introduced a new treeless data model. So typically, when you look at XML, you think of an object model or a tree-based structure, right? A parent-child relationship and so on. The problem with that aspect is when it comes to programming, right? Those of you who have used, you know, these different XML APIs, the DOM APIs and so on, know that it's like very cumbersome when it comes to manipulating the XML, right? So adding a child to a parent element and so on becomes really cumbersome. So we have taken this new approach where we simply look at an XML as a sequence, right? So most more we have other sessions where we will go into more detail and samples about this. So it's a sequence of elements, text nodes, comments, processing instructions, and so on. So XML is a primary data type, and there's an embedded literal syntax. So you can declare an XML. So in my next slide, I have an example. And XML has namespace qualification. And even in Ballerina, we have packages and so on. So we have a unified way to qualify, you know, Ballerina namespaces and XML namespaces. So this is an example. So we are declaring two XMLs, right? So one XML is a person one. So this is the literal declaration of an XML type, right? Of an XML variable called person one. So as you can see, XML is a type in the language. So we have this backtick character. So that's how you declare some of these literal values in Ballerina. So there are two person XML elements. And there is another third person XML element, which is persons. So what we are trying to do is set these as children. So you can see the plus operator or the add operator works seamlessly with XML, right? So these are not strings. So typically in a let's say Java and so on, you would declare this as a string, and then you need to use XML libraries to convert this into real XML and then, you know, manipulate the XML data model. But here you are declaring, as soon as you declare an XML like this, what happens is, you know, we can apply operators, you can call certain operations on the XML variable and so on, right? So so it makes manipulation and working with XML extremely easy. And when it comes to data, we have a type called data table. So another fundamental thing when it comes to integration is dealing with data. So data table is a fundamental or a type in Ballerina. So it represents tabular data. So the tabular data might be coming from an SQL-based database, Cassandra, MongoDB, or whatever. So the abstraction is a data table. So at the moment, so we have a session on the data integration stuff where Anjana will go into the details related to these different data formats. So an SQL connector is transaction aware. and produces streaming data tables. So you could read off, what you get is a reference to a data table, but you could be actually streaming data. So you connect to a database which has, let's say, you are fetching thousands of records. So the data table handle allows you to handle streaming data. So this is an example of a data table in action. So what we are doing is we are connecting to a MySQL database called EMPDB. So we are giving the connection parameters there. And then what we are saying is we are giving the query to fetch some of the parameters or some of the records from the database. So we're providing an SQL query there. So this is one syntax. So we are working on another query by example syntax where actually you don't have to bind to any type of SQL language. And this is interesting. The variable J, we are taking the data table and we are converting it directly into a JSON, right? So when you when you run this query, what happens is, right, you are going to get a set of records, right? So what we want to now convert that into a JSON. Let's say I want to fetch some data from my database and send it as a response to my client. So I'm a Ballerina service. I need to fetch some data from the database and send the response as JSON. So it's very simple. You just have to do a conversion from the data table variable to a JSON type, right? So the output, if you print it out, it would be something like this. If there are multiple records, right, you will have a proper JSON structure. So Ballerina knows network protocols. So it's not a second class concept. Ballerina is aware about HTTP, WebSocket, JMS, and so on. Fundamental network protocols, and there are other protocols which are built on top of this. So we support popular APIs as well. So like Facebook, Twitter, and so on are built on top of these fundamental connectors or the basic core connectors. We are building a store where we will have Ballerina connectors. So you could pick some of those connectors and include them in your Ballerina runtime, and you could simply use them. And then when it comes to authentication and so on, let's say certain endpoints or a certain API requires basic auth, right? So that becomes, those things can be added on to these fundamental connectors, right? So you could have basic auth, you could have you could have circuit breaker. So there are a bunch of stuff like that which can be added on as decorators to these fundamental connectors. And Ballerina is aware of services as well, right? So typically if you look at something like JAXRS and so on, services are second class concepts, right? So the language isn't aware of this concept of a service. So what you do is you bring in some kind of third-party library which exposes these services, right? So there are so many add-ons that you have to bring on. But in Ballerina, a service is a first-class concept. So here what we are seeing is a service which is bound to HTTP called Hello World, and we have a set of a service can have one or more resources. So a resource is another entry point. So like main, one of the other entry points to the Ballerina runtime is a resource. So here we have this resource called Say Hello, where we are passing in a request and a response, and then you could run your business, you could do your business logic within the resource and send a response. So, So services are first-class concepts. So I'm sure you can, like, so this bit at the bottom of the screen might not be visible. So you could simply, you know, run this. So you can say Ballerina run. So earlier we saw an example of how you run a main method or main function. Here you could simply, you know, say Ballerina run and give this file, and it would expose these services. So there are, let's say you need to expose these services on different ports, and you need to specify, like, your you need to expose this over HTTPS, where you need to provide your certificates and so on. So all those things are available as annotations. So this is the most basic form of a service where you don't have to provide any annotations. It will expose the service using the default value. So it will expose it on 8080 local, bound to all network interfaces on that particular machine, and so on. So Ballerina knows Swagger. So the another aspect is, like, when it comes to interface first design, that's again in many other frameworks and languages, it's an add-on. It's not a first class concept. So when it comes to interface first design, it's a bit of a pain. So in Ballerina, the Ballerina services, the code syntax, Swagger, and the graphical syntaxes are all in sync. So you can use them interchangeably, right? So you could start with a Swagger, and then you could generate your Ballerina program from that, or you could start with, let's say, the code or your composer. So Joe has a session on the composer where he will go into the details. So you can start with a graphical view, and you create your service, and then from that you could generate your Swagger. So either way, it's you could, like, it's up to you. So you could start with Swagger, you could start from your from the code directly, or you could start from the graphical interface. So here you can see the Ballerina has a Swagger command. So we are basically passing in Swagger API, right? So the Swagger JSON, right? So we are passing in the Swagger JSON, and what it will do is it will generate the relevant Ballerina files for you. So Ballerina is naturally parallel. So like I said, it's based on a sequence diagram paradigm. So you think parallel first, not sequential, right? So naturally it forces you to think about parallelism. So this is a hello world again with three workers. So workers, a worker is a unit of execution, right? So it will execute in some available thread. So here we have three workers. So when it comes to the graphical view, this is how you would see it. So worker one, worker two, worker three lifelines in the sequence diagram. And so this is the function it's going to call, println. So when you run, you will see you can't guarantee the order. So here in this run, it's printing worker one, worker two, and worker three, but it could be in any order depending on which worker got the chance to execute. And there could be other interactions, right? So so the previous sample there was not that interesting, because, you know, each worker was just printing a statement, and then it was done with it. But here you can see there are three workers. So one worker, so this line, the horizontal line, is an interaction between two workers, right? So worker one, or the default worker, is sending a particular message to worker one. Worker one is sending another message to worker two. There's some computation, and there's a response that comes back. So you can completely program your solution using, you know, workers, or, you know, or parallelism. So you could design your program with parallelism from day one. So you don't have to, that's not something that you have to bring on later on, right? So safety and resiliency. So when it comes to, Kasun was talking about microservices and so on. So when you have these interactions, so safety and resiliency are primary concerns, right? So you are talking to multiple endpoints and systems and so on. There are always, you know, there would be failures. So as a programmer, if you have to think about that and handle that, you know, your code becomes really messy and it gets complicated very fast. So what we have is a proper, you know, resiliency framework built into the different connectors, transports and so on. And when it comes to network delivered data, you have to always do chain checking, right? For example, you have to check if you are getting a call and you are doing some database operations, you have to check whether there's an SQL injection attack coming in, right? So you have to do the chain checking of the data. So all that is burnt in to the language. So when you go into the other sessions, you'll be able to see those in detail. And so built-in retrying, failover, load balancing, these are all primary parts of the language. And transactions are another fundamental part. So so this is a structure of a particular transaction. So you could give like different transaction guarantees. So you can say, I need the transaction with ACID, and then retry based on some sort of expression. And if the transaction fails, you can execute some statements. And let's say say like retry three times, right? So you can go back and try to execute the statement. And if the transaction was aborted, the abort statement will get executed. And when it is committed, the committed block of code will get executed. So this bit is still under design. So this is how like so transactions have been treated as a fundamental part in Ballerina. And again, a common requirement is data transformations when it comes to different systems interacting with each other. So this is a diagram from the Composer where we are converting one type of data, the source, to a different type of data, the target. So the Composer allows you to sort of give a mapping between these fields. So you could call inter like functions in the middle which will do further transformation. So this is how it looks in code. So we are defining a transformer, right? So we are transforming this person to a user, right? So person is a struct. We are transforming to a user. So this is the textual representation of the same diagram, right? So visualizing this graphically makes it easier to see how the transformation happens, right? So it's very convenient to see the graphical view of that particular transformation. So once you have defined this transformation, you can do, so I'm defining this person struct, right? I'm defining a person, I'm defining an instance of the person struct. So I'm getting that and transforming it to a user. So what happens is automatically the default transformation gets called, and this particular transformation logic will give you the proper user object. So this is a very powerful concept because it makes, you know, when it comes to interacting different, integrating different systems, the transformations become, you know, so much easier and so much, you know, this kind of code is so much maintainable. And then one of the key aspects, again, when it comes to an integration system is, you know, you have to read and write data, right? So so this is a layered architecture diagram where like we have organized our APIs into different levels. So at the fundamental level, you have, you know, channels, IO channels. So you have files, sockets, and so on. What you get from any of these channels is bytes, right? So you can deal with these bytes directly. So there's a byte IO API for you to deal with it. Or you could have a set of bytes. You could combine a set of bytes into characters. So let's say at a different level, you need to just deal with characters. So there's a character IO API which allows you to do that. And there could be other record formats, right? So you could have, let's say, you can define saying 10 bytes constitute one record. So there's a, that's a binary record. So you could have binary records, or you could say we have a CSV record where a particular record is, it has a field delimiter and a record delimiter. So there can be various record formats like CSV and so on. So depending on these different aspects, so we have provided a clean API for you to be able to read and write data. Right? So we have endpoints, connectors, and actions. So an endpoint is an external endpoints are logical entities that represent remote services. So let's say you have a Twitter endpoint or a Facebook endpoint and so on. And the way you connect to that is through a connector, right? So you have a Facebook connector, Twitter connector, and so on to connect to the Facebook API endpoint, right? So once you make a connector or a connector instance, it's called a connection, and then you can invoke actions. So connectors, endpoints, connectors, connections, and actions are fundamental aspects when it comes to network level interactions. And another primary aspect is Docker. So just using the Ballerina Docker command, you could make a Docker image using your Ballerina program. And it's open source, it's patent pending technology, licensed under the Apache software license. So the project development is happening at this URL, so Ballerina Lang organization at GitHub. And then we have our community aspects all handled. We have our Slack channel and Twitter, Stack Overflow, and most of the interactions happen on this Google group, the Ballerina Dev Google group. So all of you are welcome to participate in that and give feedback and so on. So it's still at 0.95 preview. So try it out. And tomorrow we will have a buff session. We are, you guys can come. All of you can come and participate. Try it out. You can become Ballerina contributors. And so on. So we can discuss more about that in the buff tomorrow. So it's more than a language. There are IDE plugins and plugins for other editors. And then there are other aspects that we have thought about. So testing is a fundamental aspect. So you don't have to like bring in another library to be able to test your Ballerina program. So we have that as a fundamental aspect. So we call it Testerina. And then documenting your programs and your APIs and so on, that's another fundamental aspect that is also, it's not an afterthought. So like Java, in Java, right? You have the Java doc annotations and so on. Those are like brought on as an afterthought. So in Dockerina, what you have done is it's a fundamental aspect of Ballerina. So from day one, what we do is we force the programmers or help the programmers do the correct thing, and like packaging your program, right? So you might once you write your program, it might be in like different packages, or it could be in different Ballerina files. So packaging that, so you don't have to look for a different tool. We have a tool that's already built for that. So we called it Packerina, which allows you to pack your binaries and manage that and so on. So thank you. So if you have any questions, I think I can have a couple of minutes to take questions. Yeah. You have the mic.
Actually, when we took a new attempt to build our platform, we basically had three things in mind. We came from a Java world. We thought about getting the enterprise service bus, as Paul mentioned it this morning, as a sort of an anti-pattern, being just an orchestration tool. So now we would get an integration service building tool with what you built. And there are three things that we actually had in mind when we took the decision to go the Arcascala road that I don't see here, and I would be interested in your answers. The first thing is we took it because we could still access all these Java libraries, and you say you don't need them because you are building connectors, but still there's so much out there, and we would still just currently at least lose it if we just took this. And then there's the JVM as a proven rock solid runtime environment, so I have no clue from what I understand so far what this is now operations wise and how does it really scale. And we took this actor model because it is the right balance for us between the limitations that come with multi-threading as compared to something that just runs on one thread in an event loop as Node.js does. So how does your tooling or your platform compare in these three dimensions?
Okay, the second question, so it's we build on top of the JVM, so all the benefits of the JVM will be, you know, available for you, right? So Ballerina currently builds on top of JVM. So, but the thing is, like, the Java aspects have not leaked into the language itself, right? Currently, so you can benefit from all the benefits of the JVM. And that the first question was, so you have so many third-party libraries out there, and you know, if we just do we start from scratch, are we going to lose the benefits of that? No, still, if you want to use some of those third-party libraries, one of the you might bring it in as a connector, or you could write a separate service. So we have a separate framework called the MSFJ or microservices framework for Java, or you could use Spring Boot or whatever, and expose that as an endpoint to which you would interact with, right? So that's one way of integrating with that aspect. So like you still can have the benefit of those services. You don't have to completely ditch those third-party libraries. And the third question was so the actor model and parallelism are basically the fundamental aspects. So it's when we go through the composer session next, you'll see that it's completely based on actors and interactions between actors and so on, right? So the workers are actually actors in the system, and then even the endpoints are actors that we interact with. So that actor model is a fundamental thing in Ballerina. Any other questions?
Can you embed the third party libraries as a library?
You could embed third party.
Without creating a new microservice for J connection.
Yes, that's certainly possible. So we have this concept of native libraries. So you can embed it, but we might, depending on the use case, that might make sense, or it might make sense to have it as a separate process, and run it as separate Docker container or whatever, and just make a network call to that. Or if, like, depending on your case, you could still embed it, but we have to consider it on a case by case basis. So like our general recommendation would be don't embed it, expose it as a separate microservice to which you can integrate with. But depending on your case, you might be able to do that.
Looks like Ballerina is putting focus to publish swap definitions. What about swap definitions, swap services?
We are working on SOAP, so still we have a connector, but the SOAP support is still, we are still working on that. So at the moment, we are working on a SOAP connector, which allows you to connect to SOAP endpoints, but we haven't implemented a way to, expose SOAP services.
What about expose SOAP services?
At the moment, we don't have that, so that's something that we could consider for the future. So you could, at the moment, you could receive HTTP messages. You could receive XML, your payload could be XML or JSON and so on, and you could talk to a SOAP endpoint over there. But at the moment there is no like direct way to, there's no SOAP engine on the server side. Shall we go to the next session? So to continue from my session, we have Joseph, who's leading the Composer project, and he'll be talking about the Ballerina Composer.